So I start again. And I will, so it's still course one, but I will cover more fastly course two. So I want to explain now what happens where you are no longer strongly convex, what type of IDs, so I will not cover all the details, but what type of IDs you can have to still get the same type of results. So we just cover the case where you have simply super exponential densities. So we explain what is it, and convex densities. And to answer a question raised by Professor Martinelli, so Fabio, he asked me, so I will not present the optimal result because I have a lot of results which appear on the dependence and the dimensions. I use the result I know, and I tried to do that yesterday afternoon, but I was not fresh enough to review all the literature which has appeared since 2017. So there are a lot of papers which have appeared since then that I will not mention. In particular, there are a lot of papers by two teams. One team which is with Michael Jordan. So you know Michael Jordan, the famous guy in machine learning, so in Berkeley. So he has an industry. So perhaps he has 50 postdocs. So he's publishing a paper per week, as I said, last year. He was visiting Paris in 2013. He was invited for 1 year in Paris. And so what we so the plan was to we give him support. We say, okay, you can invite one postdoc for 1 week every week, but he has invited 50 postdocs. This is what I know that he has 50 postdocs. It's incredible. So they have published a lot of papers recently, and there is one. If you want to look at the last result. He has written a paper for PNAS. So it's, I think it's Ma, Flammarion, Jordan. I think Peter Bartlett, perhaps Martin Wainwright. So they always have 50 authors also. So it's 50 papers multiplied by 50 authors multiplied by 50 pages. I'm not sure exactly of the name. Flammarion was there, Michael Jordan was there. And it's a paper called something like sampling can be faster than sampling faster than optimization, something like this. It's not exact. So it's a kind of provocative thing like that. So where he says that sampling, and if you look at that, I think he has he did a presentation at the last ICM meeting in Rio. So he explained part of this, and I think it's more or less in this result. But the first theorem he has there is very surprising. So I read that yesterday. Then I go to Gersand. We were preparing our Mysore trip on Sunday, so I stopped there. But it's really, really surprising. So it's too good. So the first result in this paper, I think, is too good to be true. Okay, I don't want to pretend it is wrong, but it's very surprising. This is why I did not mention it. What I will show is that the way we proceed. When you are not strongly concave, and in which case, of course, it's a bit more complicated because you don't have such a nice structure, and so you need to do a little bit differently. So, okay, typically, I will start with in the case of super exponential density, but basically, the arguments which can be used in such case. Get also a result in another case, which is it's globally convex and strongly convex outside the ball. So I will look at that. And what Jordan remove there is that he removes the fact that you need to be convex everywhere. So in particular, you can treat what is written there, so which is a double Wells potential. And he has even obtained better results than us, apparently. Okay, so we discuss how you proceed when you go to a strongly convex case. So, not strongly convex, a super exponential density case. So basically what you assume is that you assume that the potential at infinity grows like rho to the power y alpha for y larger than m rho. So implicitly, of course, I put there a simple condition like that. Of course, you can, so the good condition, so typically it can be satisfied at one point. But basically, it means what? It means that at infinity, what you want to avoid is that the potential at infinity becomes too weak. So you need to have, so at infinity, you need that the potential kick you back to the center of the space. Okay, otherwise you will not be, you will not have an exponential convergence. You will have something which is polynomial or Riemannian. In order to expect to have exponential convergence, you need to have a potential when you are far at infinity, brings you back home. Okay. When you are in Bangalore, you need to go back to Paris sometimes. So you need the potential is large in finite time. Okay. So this is the type of condition we have. And what you can prove is that if U is super exponential, then V of X, and you take in that case exponential U of X divided by 2, is a Lyapunov function. So remember that pi of X is proportional to exponential minus U X. So which means that you take V of X, which is pi of X minus 1/2. It's often in the general theory of Markov chain or in the theory of diffusion, it's often a good Lyapunov function when you know the stationary distribution. So this is, for example, in MCMC algorithm, so you know the stationary distributions, and it's a good idea in general to use pi of X like that. So it's most of the analysis, for example, for random walk metropolis or for has been done with this type of drift function. So remember, in fact, that if you remember with the drift function that we use in strongly convex case was simply V of X equal X minus X square, X minus X star to the square. So it means here V of X will be much steeper. Okay. So in fact, it's here it's linked with the fact that it depends on how much strong is the way you are coming back to home. So this is why here we take this Lyapunov function. So Lyapunov function, so formally it is defined there. Lyapunov function is a function which is in C2, so it's you even have other conditions to satisfy to belong to the core of the generator. To the domain of generator, sorry, okay, so it's a function which satisfies the condition like that. So it means that first you have that, and it means that under this condition, what you can prove that you have a geometric convergence. So if you take the diffusion. The Langevin diffusion, and if you find a function which satisfies the Lyapunov condition, in fact, you will have geometric convergence of the diffusion, but with constants which are not necessarily explicit. So the only thing I need to know there is that when you have this, when this condition is satisfied, so which means if I have a Lyapunov function, which means that this condition is satisfied with some outside of, so it means that AV is less than minus theta V outside of some ball, then the diffusion will be ergodic and also will converge geometrically fast with stationary distribution, but perhaps the rate at which it will converge to stationary distribution will be, it depends the way, the dependence of this on the constant of the diffusion is perhaps more or less explicit, but that's another issue. Okay, so I look at this, R gamma n, and what I will need to prove that, I will need to prove that the Markov kernel R gamma also satisfies, in fact, drift condition. So basically, if I take a super exponential density, first the diffusion as the Lyapunov function converges, so the diffusion converges exponentially fast to its stationary distribution, and also the discretized version of it is a Markov chain which satisfies a Foster Lyapunov drift, okay, which is like this, R gamma V less than kappa gamma plus gamma B, where kappa is some number which can be computed, of course, explicitly, And it's funny to see how this quantity depends on gamma. So it's in, it plays a key role, in fact. This expression for the Foster-Lyapunov drift condition plays a key role. So the weight depends on gamma. So it means that you should have something like, because when gamma is equal to zero, of course you don't have convergence. Okay? When gamma is equal to zero, you stay at a point. So when gamma is equal to zero, it means that you stay at x square. So you don't have any convergence, of course. But if you don't have any convergence, so you have R0. R0, it means it's simply delta. So it's delta V of x is V. So you take gamma equal to zero, you have kappa gamma would be equal to one. So it's okay. So it means that when gamma goes small, you don't simply need to have a Foster-Lyapunov condition. You need to have a Foster-Lyapunov condition with constants which depends explicitly on gamma in such a way. So in the way which it should be something like, so kappa gamma, so it should be exponential of, it's something like exponential of gamma b, so something like this. When gamma goes to zero, it should go to one, but this constant should go to zero. Okay? And it is true in that case. In the super exponential case, you are able to prove something like this with explicit gamma, kappa, and b. Okay? Okay? So basically, you have this result. So when U is L smooth, and if you assume that you have a super exponential density, then you might find that if you take gamma, which is less than 1 over L, which is the Lipschitz constant of the function, then you can find B, which is explicit, and kappa, which is such that this quantity is satisfied. And you also take V of x, which is exponential U of x divided by 2. Okay, so you have two things. You have, using this, you can control, and this is what I do there. So when you have an expression like that, okay, what you can do, you can control the moments, okay? So remember that Q gamma NP is equal to R gamma N to R gamma P. So Q gamma N is simply when you start from P equals zero, so it's P equal one, sorry. So it's Q gamma N. And so you simply use, you take this equation, R gamma, and you apply it several times, and you will obtain something like this. And this is where it's important to have kappa to the power gamma, so it's because it means that here you will have kappa to the power gamma 1n, so gamma n is the sum of gamma k, okay? So which is the total time, it's the total amount of time spent by the diffusion, so it's important, this is why it's important to have a dependence in gamma like this, and then you have gamma I times this. So which means that if you have this condition, typically what you know is that this condition will be bounded by something like this. So if you take, for example, gamma constant, it means when gamma goes to infinity, this one, gamma n goes to infinity, the big gamma goes to infinity, this one will go to zero, and this means that this goes to a constant, and this also will go to zero. So which means that basically Q gamma n V will be typically bounded. Okay, good. So now how do you proceed? How do you proceed in general? It's very simple. So what you do is that you will choose a point n. So you can do better, of course, if you are really taking care about constants, you can do better than that. But you fix, so P is the total horizon, okay? And you fix an intermediate point n, okay? And you decompose this error. You decompose it in two terms. A term where you start from n, okay? So n is a point between p. You start from zero. You run the discretization at time n, and then you will run the diffusion from time gamma n to time gamma p. Okay, and then of course you sandwich it. So you take this point. So you take this. So this is q gamma p. So you can decompose it like that, and then you have the second point which is decomposed like that. Okay, and if you look at that, of course, it will not be optimal. It's just to give an idea of the proof. In fact, what you will do is something like this. This part, in fact, will be easy to handle. Well, it will be easy to handle because it's linked with the rate at which the semigroup of the diffusion forgets its initial condition, because P is the semigroup of the diffusion, pi is the stationary distribution for the semigroup of the diffusion. So this term is exactly the rate at which the semigroup of the diffusion relaxes to pi. So provided that you know results on the diffusion process, this part will be, you simply open a book, you look at what are the results that you can obtain for diffusion process, and you simply have to plug in total variation, and you simply have to plug this result. There are a lot of results. So I mentioned the book by Ledoux, Yvan Gentil, and Bacri. There are a lot of results. In particular, there are a lot of results for the diffusion in the convex case, not strongly convex, but the convex case. There are results by Bob Korb, there are many results on that. Okay. So which means that, but there are many results for the diffusion, because the diffusion is always simpler than the discretized version. So the diffusion is always, you have a lot of tools that in discrete time, in general, it's a bit more, it's more complex in discrete time than in continuous time. So you have a lot of results for this. So we will care about this result. So now how do we compare this? Okay, the total variation distance between these two results. Okay, and then what we will do is that we will do also a coupling. The argument I will use, in fact, is a coupling followed by a kind of change of measure. So what I will do is the following. So I can use a coupling. So we try to do we couple the diffusion and its discretized version. So it's something which has been suggested here. So it's, of course, it's very classical in the analysis of diffusion. So you start with you drive the diffusion is driven by the same Brownian path here and here, and then simply you replace here gradient of u of yt, you replace it by this quantity, which is the it's a path dependent, so it's no longer a diffusion in the proper sense, but you simply replace it by this discretization. And then you can use a change of measure, a change of measure like that, so you know if you have a two diffusion type process, so it's a, I've taken this result from Lipster and Chirayev, but you can find it in many books. So if you take two diffusion type process, so AT here and BT are non-anticipative functional of the path. It's not, there is no Xi T there. It's a BT of Xi. So it's non-anticipative, meaning that it's a functional which depends upon all the paths up to time T. Okay. And you suppose that that these two diffusion type process have a unique continuous strong solution. So you assume the existence of strong solution for these two process. If you can prove this for any fixed T, so if you can prove that this quantity is satisfied, then you can prove that the law of the process psi and the law of process eta are mutually equivalent. So they have you can find the expression for these two expressions give you it's a Gersanov theorem for diffusion type process. So you know the Gersanov theorem for it means what? It means that you can apply the Gersanov theorem not for diffusion but for diffusion type process. Okay? Under some conditions. And in particular, there is a very nice result which gives you the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the law of Xi and the law of eta. Okay, so which is given by something which is given by that. Okay, so you have this result, and you can apply this result to this process. So it's so if you look at these two processes, so you have they are driven by the same Brownian path. The first process is really a diffusion. The second process is a diffusion type process, driven by the same Brownian path. Okay, so you apply the result by Lipser and Chirayev. You have to prove, of course, that this condition is satisfied, but it's not so difficult because you can compute moments. You can prove also that the functional are non-anticipative. It's very easy, and you can also prove that there are unique strong solutions for this equation. So it is clear for the diffusion. And it's also clear for this because it's a discrete type process, so you can really obtain a single, there is a single strong solution. So these two conditions are satisfied. Then you can compute the Kullback-Leibler divergence between these two processes. And the Kullback-Leibler divergence between these two processes is the expectation of if you look at this, you take the square of the AS minus BS to the square, and you integrate with, and you take, so I take this, so it, there is no S, sorry, there. Okay, so you integrate this quantity. You simply have to control the expectation of this difference of delta US Y bar S minus delta bar Y bar, so there is not S there, S to the square. Okay, so you have to compute this. And this controls the Kullback-Leibler distance, but you have you know that total variation is less than 1 over 2 the square root of Kullback-Leibler, so you can also compute it controls also the total variation distance, and it's computed by the entropy, so it's a nice result. And the thing which is very nice there is that this quantity, in fact, depends only on the it's not exactly the discrete process, but it's a discretization of the process. It's a continuous interpolation of the discrete time process. So it's typically easy to control this type of expectation. Okay, this expectation will be easy to control. So when you use this quantity, if you assume that U is L smooth, well, which is clear, then you have an explicit control of that. So it's a you simply use the fact that it is L-smooth because you have a difference of the two, and then you integrate, so it's given by this. So it's easy to verify. And then what you obtain is that since you know how to control, because XK is a discrete time process, so because you have a drift function, you know how to control this quantity, but then you obtain you obtain the result, basically, provided that you know, so in order to obtain a general, using this type of approach, what you need to know basically two things. You need to know the rate at which the semi-group of the diffusion relaxes to its stationary distribution pi. So you have to use results obtained for the diffusion process. And then you need to know how to control moments, because if you use the Pinsker inequality to use the first part, you need to control the moment for the discretization. So it's basically very easy. There is a simple-minded way to do this. You need to control the moments, and you need to control the convergence of the diffusion. So we did that in our paper, which is appear now in Annals of Applied Probability. We did that in two cases, so super exponential case and a convex case. But in the first case, when you are simply super exponential, you have an exponential dependence in the dimension. So there is no good dependence in the dimension. And the second case we have covered is a convex case. In the convex case, we use result for when U is the potential is simply convex, and we use the result by Bobkov, in fact, which gives, in fact, more or less the optimal rate, for the optimal. It's the best constant known for the contraction rate of the semi-group of the diffusion. If you do this, you can prove that. You can prove something like this. So you have pi gamma minus pi TV is a constant times square root of gamma, so it's a bit strange, because what we obtain, so what you expect is that pi gamma minus pi should be something like c gamma. So with this type of result, we obtain square root of gamma. I'm not sure it's optimal, but that's life. Because it's a first order method, so you expect gamma and not pi square root of gamma, but with this type of technique, you obtain gamma. And this is a result that we are just to show the type of how much you lose by simply assuming that U is convex. You have if you take simply constant epsilon and U convex, And you look at the same criterion, you know that the optimal number of simulations should be d to the power 5. Okay? And it was square root of d in the strongly convex case. So we lose a lot in that case. Ah, we bound Kullback-Leibler. So it's in fact, we could have bound Kullback-Leibler directly. That would be possible. Because we have a bound, we did total variation, but we could have, because we have a bound for the Kullback-Leibler, and we have also a bound because there is entropy bound, so there is a total variation, but there are also entropy bound for the diffusion. So we could have bounded Kullback-Leibler. I think it has been done by Giordano, so he brought things like that also. Yeah, we couple on the same. You couple with the same on the same Brownian path. So you have the same Brownian path, and you construct the coupling on the same Brownian path. So it's the same. So you start with the Brownian path, and then you construct the two diffusion on this Brownian with the same Brownian path. In that case, and in general, otherwise no. Otherwise, you need to couple. When you do the coupling, otherwise you need to construct a product space. And here, in that case, it's very simple because the coupling is simply you run the same Brownian path. And then you construct the two diffusions. So you start by constructing the polarity space on which you define the Brownian motion, and then you construct the two diffusions on this process. But otherwise, it's more complicated. In general, it's more complicated. In general, you need to construct a product space and prove that the process is defined on this product space. Okay, so that's the general type of proof, and of course, So if you do that, you obtain typically the good rate, but not the good constant. So what you typically do, so instead of using a single n, then you will do a type of telescoping sum. So you will chunk this. So you will use depending if gamma is non-constant, it's a bit messy. But what you will do typically is that to improve the bounds. You improve a lot of bounds by not taking on single n, but by taking several n. And every time you use contraction of the diffusion, and every time you construct on some chunks, you use the Kullback-Leibler distance to control, in fact, the rate at which, in fact, the discretization deviates from the diffusion. Because you have two terms. You start from mu0 q gamma n, and you have here the discretization, this is the diffusion term, and you simply try to compute how fast the two things diverge. So you can do better in terms of constant by... Okay, and so using this type of proof, in fact, you have a lot of results which have appeared recently, and so this is why there are better results. They have better results which have appeared recently in this paper by Maë Flammarion. So for example, what we obtained, for example, so if we are simply convex, it's D5, and if it is convex outside the ball, okay, it's convex everywhere and strongly convex outside the ball, you get a much better dependence between D log D, okay? But then, of course, you have a dependence on R, so which means R to the power 8. So it depends. So it's not always better, but it's... And then starting from this result, there are better results because... But basically, they all the time use the same type of proof, so the type of proof which I outlined earlier, so the type of proof where you use this type of decomposition to relate the two. Okay, so I will skip this. Because you are probabilists, or you are not very interested in numerics, or you are not engineers. And I will go to some applications. Okay, so I'll go to some applications which correspond to different papers I've written more or less recently. So I first have an extension that I will explain to non-smooth potential, and it should be related to what Gersand has presented to you. So it's linked with proximal stuff. So it's a paper which appears in SIAM journal on imaging, because we have a lot of application to uncertainty quantification in inverse problem in image processing. So there is a second paper which is on the low concave density with constraint domain. So we have two papers on this, how to sample a convex density, but which is restricted to a domain. So, for example, one of obvious application in Bayesian stuff is in many application in Bayesian statistics, you have to sample the distribution over probability. Forget the word in English, but simplex. Okay. You can also obtain deviation equation. So it's a paper which appeared in CORT. So CORT is a machine learning conference. So it's computational learning theory. So it's I will explain if I have time a little bit how you obtain deviation inequalities. It's in a supplementary paper, by the way, from a Bernoulli paper. So it's a third part, but we put it in a supplementary paper. And it's related to techniques which have been outlined by Yann Olivier. Perhaps you know his paper on the discrete Ricci curvature and things like that. So it's not so different. It's more or less an application of this type of ideas. And then we have a last paper, but I don't think I have time to explain, on how to compute normalizing constant of log concave density and also to the volume of convex body. But I'm not sure that I have time to explain that. So there are a lot of applications, and I'm sure that Gerson did a very good job to explain why it's so important. Is that instead of having a smooth potential, you have a potential where which is a composite function, so where you have a smooth part, which is in statistics, which typically means the likelihood, and you have a non-smooth part, G, which will be typically in statistics, will be the penalization term. So it's especially important when you are looking in high dimension, because the way the penalty enter into play is very important. So for example, we can have you have type of example, a constrained lasso or constrained ridge regression. So in that case, G, we typically have, so it's a constrained lasso or ridge regression. Typically, G will have a L1 part, and also you take it, it would be the characteristic of K will be typically a convex set. And one K will be the characteristic of the convex set. But it's also you have application for lasso type stuff, for fused lasso type model. So there are a lot of application where G is not smooth. So what we did with Alain and Marcelo Pereira, so we did, so we were willing to use what we did for in the Euler discretization. And what we try to do is to regularize the potential G. But to use regularization, so yeah, there are many ways to regularize functions, to take a function which is non-smooth and to make it smooth. But we were willing to do things. We were willing to preserve the convexity of U, if U is convex, because we were willing to preserve the rate of convergence that we know. And we want that the regularization of U be continuously differentiable. We want it to be gradient Lipschitz also. And of course, we want to make a regularization where we were able to control in total variation the distance between the regularized version of the potential and the potential itself, because we were willing to sample something which is not too far from pi. And so what we did is that we did the following thing. So we did what we call Moreau Yoshida regularization. So Moreau is a French mathematician, c'est René Moreau. So he's someone working in Montpellier in the Grothendieck lab, and he did optimization, but it was more people from mechanics. So he did a lot on non-smooth problem in mechanics, but he has introduced this very nice idea of proximal operator, so which is defined like that. So you take a function G, so we can define it in a more general case, but assume for the time being that the function G is convex and lower semi-continuous, and you take some positive lambda, and what we call the Moreau-Yoshida envelope, G lambda, is defined like this, so it's defined like the infimum over y in Rd of gy plus 1 over 2 lambda of x minus y to the square, okay? So, of course, this problem has a solution because g is supposed to be convex, so you add 1 over 2 lambda x minus y to the square, so this function becomes strongly convex, so which means that you have this infimum as a single minimum. So you have a single solution to this infimum, and this the value of the function and this infimum is known to be the more defined the Morio-Sida envelope of the function g. And it's easy to see that it is less than g of x, because if you take inside this infimum, if you take y equal x, you will have g of x. So you have g lambda of x, which is necessarily less than g of x. It's an envelope. It's a lower bound of g of x, and the infimum is achieved at a unique point. Remember that g is convex. This is which makes this function is strongly convex. The point at which a minimum is achieved is called the proximal point, which is characterized by this inequality. So it means that x minus the proximal point should belong to gamma times the subdifferential of g at the proximal point, so that the characterization of this optimum. And you know a lot about the proximal point, at least in some simple case. Because there are some properties of the proximal operators. I know that Gerson should have presented it, because it's very important also in optimization. So the first property is that the Morio-Sida envelope converges to g as lambda goes to zero, okay? It's not super surprising, because when lambda goes to zero, you force, in fact, the penalization to be higher and higher, so you as soon as you go far from g, you are bring back to g, so it converges to g of x. You can prove that g lambda is convex and continuously differentiable. And you have an expression for the gradient which is very simple, so you need to remember this. So the expression of the gradient is given by that. And in many cases, not in many cases, but for function g which are used in statistics, like L1 or then you have an explicit expression for the proximal operator. So the prox can be computed explicitly, at least in many cases, or can be if it in many other examples. Perhaps you cannot compute the prox explicitly. There is no closed form expression for the prox, but you can solve a very simple problem to approximate it numerically. So the gradient of g of lambda in that case can be approached very precisely.
Is it a simple approximation?
That's a prox we've taken with p lambda. So it's proxy. For example, if you take L1, so the proximal point in L1 is so you can compute it. So it's this type of, you obtain this type of stuff. Okay, so it's a kind of this type of regularization. It's not on the log, huh, but it's a. Okay, it's easy to see, because it's if you take L1. The prox is, so if g of x is L1, so you can compute the prox lambda g at a point x, and it will be the prox at that point, proximal operator at that point is soft thresholding operator, okay. And then you reintegrate this on the. So the prox is a soft thresholding operator. So you can plug it back and you obtain. So in that case, typically when you have a function like that, when you have a function like this, so in that case the prox would be something like. So you have something like, I think it's 1 over 2 lambda, so I have to check, okay. So, and then it would be something like, so it will be continuous like that, and it's above, okay. It will be quadratic there, so it is, you replace it by, so it will be exactly like you, it will be exactly like after a certain value, it will be exactly like then, and then it will be a small quadratic part, which is typically this, in the L1 case. Okay, so what will we prove? So it's a stupid thing I did not correct. I noticed that this morning at 9:15 is that the number of the assumption are in blue, red, in blue, so it's difficult to see that. So it's H1, okay. So U is F plus G, you assume that G is convex, F is NRD, you assume that F is greater than Lipschitz, with Lipschitz constant L of F, and what we will assume is that G is lower continuous, so it's exponential minus GY dy. Okay, so what we know is that G lambda is convex, G lambda is continuously differentiable, G lambda is greater than Lipschitz, so you satisfy this. And of course, in that case, U lambda, so which is F plus G lambda, is convex, continuously differentiable, and also greater than Lipschitz. What you have to prove, basically, it's not much, but you have to prove that because you have regularized G, it's not completely clear that this define a proper potential. Remember that to be a proper potential, what you need to prove is that exponential minus U lambda of X should be integrable. So you should prove something like this. And what we prove is that we prove exactly this. We prove that for any lambda positive, this remains to be so, which is not super surprising in the sense, in some sense, because G, provided that you have this, of course, exponential minus G of X, G of Y, dy is, and G is convex, you can prove that G lambda remains integrable. That's, yes, you have, it's not so difficult, but there are some conditions to check in full generality. So you, what you sample, basically, is you will define pi lambda, which is exponential minus U of lambda, which is given by that. So U lambda is an approximation of pi lambda, and what you have pi lambda minus pi in total variation is bounded by something which is of order lambda. So you have an explicit control, you have an explicit control of how far the pi lambda is from pi. And notice also something is that, in fact, you have an explicit expression for the density pi lambda, which is exponential minus U lambda. So which means that even, so because what we will do typically is that we will sample not pi, but pi lambda, okay? But we can, at the end of the sampling, we can always use acceptance rejection step, so we can use an important sampling step in order to correct the stationary distribution. So because you have an explicit expression, and you know what is the difference minus U lambda minus U of X. So because when you look at what is importance weights, the importance weights will be U of X minus U lambda of X. Okay, it's F of X plus GX minus F of X minus G lambda X. So it's f of x there. So which means that basically, what you need the importance weight will be g minus g lambda x, and g minus g lambda are quantities that you can compute explicitly. So which means that ever it's not so a big problem to sample pi lambda, because at the end of the day you can correct for this bias in a final step by using an importance acceptance by using important sampling. Of course, it should be because this ratio, so lambda typically we should be chosen according to the dimension, because if the dimension is large, the fluctuation of pi lambda, so you have to take that into account. Because of course, if you use a super smooth lambda, imagine that you use a super smooth lambda, a lambda large, so you smooth a lot. So of course, you will have a better potential. So it will be faster to sample, okay? But then when you look at the fluctuation linked with importance weight at the end of the day, of course, it is not necessarily very good to do this. So it means that you have a kind of compromise to satisfy when you choose the smoothing factor lambda between when you use a large smoothing factor, then the diffusion will be easy to sample, but then you will have a large fluctuation in the important sampling weight. So there is this is why it's better to understand exactly what you have to do. Well, we need this type of optimization at least in some cases. Yeah, you have to optimize. So that's the type of pi lambda. So in dimension one, when you use this optimization, so is that for a square? So this is pi lambda, so it's a square, and then you have this switch with exponential minus x4, this exponential minus x. Okay. So what we do? So we use what we call the Majula. We call the Majula algorithm. So the Majula algorithm. So you target pi lambda, which is exponential minus u lambda, where you replace. You use a Euler discretization for this. So it's a gradient plus the gradient of g lambda, which is given by that. So it's completely explicit in that case, which is Majula. M stands for Majula there, ZK. And then what you do at the end of the day is that you obtain a sample from pi lambda and you correct it by, when you compute moments, for example, you correct it by importance ratio, so you have to compute at the same time pi of x divided by pi lambda of xk, and then you obtain, if you do that, you obtain a sample from pi, okay, because you have used an additional importance rejection step. Okay? Okay, that's it. So it works quite well, so we skip this example. Okay, so it's I will explain for probabilists how you do example in engineering. So examples should be always much better than all the others. So, and your algorithm is always tuned to, so you spend a lot of time on your algorithm to tune everything very well, and you take default parameter for the others, which are completely out of the game. You say, okay, look, and because nobody will reproduce your experiment, you're happy, okay? And also you show only the example where it works well. Okay, so that's the rule of the game, okay? And everybody knows that, so it's not a problem. My method is always whether the scale is very well, so the other's method are difficult to even to see on the right scale, you know? Okay. So that's a paper the most of the papers in this IAM paper is most on experiments and how to use that in large dimensions. So in fact, it works well in the sense that we were able to do uncertainty analysis. So interesting problem. In fact, just I will explain in 1 minute. So the type of problem we had, we give you how we use that with Marcelo. And so you start with, it's an image deblurring problem. So the problem is there is to count cells. So you have a microscope, so it's a live cell microscopy, so it's data from Zoo 2012. So it's very, the scale is very small, huh? It's nanometer. So and you want to come to detect the number, to count the number of cells in this type of image. So you have a blurring operator. So blur is blur which is introduced by the imaging system, and this is a reconstruction that you obtain by using a maximum posteriori estimate. So it's points, of course. You use sparsity inducing. So here it's L1. So in order to get a result like that, you use L1. So you threshold the things. And what we were doing there, so I did not explain how we do that, but we did that by doing uncertainty quantification for the in some regions there, in order to have the uncertainty of the points that you have reconstructed. And that these regions are uncertainty quantification regions. So which means that some points are well identified, and some points, when you have region like that, it means that the precision of the location is not very, it's sometimes not very good. Okay, so this is a type of application, and this is a very big image. I don't remember the number of points, but it's very big. I don't remember, so it's because it's very big. In fact, the number of pixels is very large, so it's something like perhaps 1 million samples, 1 million pixels. So, and it took us 4 minutes on a standard computer to do this. So it's much, much better than the classical method which has been used so far. And the estimation error is 0.2. Yep. Yeah, everything is optimized there. Yeah, because lambda. When you do lambda, because it's a bit complicated to choose lambda, because when you take a given function, you have to compute the fluctuation. So for the Monte Carlo estimate, and the fluctuation will depend upon lambda, because it will depend, and then you have to optimize lambda with respect to that. You know, it's a. It doesn't depend upon this lambda. Is the lambda that we use is the lambda that we use in the regularization is completely is a kind of is not a lambda of the regularization that we use in Lasso. It's a lambda. It's a kind if you the lambda that we use there is a we choose the lambda like we want. We choose the lambda like we want, because it's simply the thing that we have to, the type of trade-off that we have to do is a trade-off between the ease at which we can sample this potential and the fluctuations that we introduce when we look at the fluctuation of the importance weight. It has nothing to do with some regularization that we really use in Lasso. So then I will just in 2 minutes I will look at this. So it's so what we did in fact is also we using this type of techniques we were able to look at sampling of low concave density in a convex domain. So you want to sample on a convex domain. So what you do there is that you take a potential U, which is F plus the convex indicator of the convex body K, which is given by that. And what we did there is that we just regularize the regularization in that case of the convex indicator is given by this. It's a Projka is a projection on X, so that gives you an ID, so which means when you are inside the convex, it would be zero, so it's okay. And when you are far away, okay, it would be x minus this projection divided by 1/2 lambda. Okay, so it's not infinity, but when lambda is small, it becomes very large. Okay, so sampling into a convex domain, there are many, many algorithms which has been proposed so far. It's a big problem in computational algorithms. So there are a lot of papers by Vampala, Lovash, Fries, Paulson, so there are many, many papers. And so in fact, we started from paper by Bubek, Eldan, and Leek, which is called the Projected Langevin Monte Carlo, where what they do basically is that they do Langevin diffusion and they project at each iteration. But when you do that, in fact, when you do a projection, of course, when you are close to the boundary, you don't have the correct distribution. So they were forced to do a lot of things which were not so good. And what we propose, we propose Mula, and we were able to prove this. So we assume that F is Lipschitz. Okay, we have choose that the convex set is well rounded. So well rounded is something like the convex set is not too complex. So you have two balls like that. And with what we were able to prove under this assumption is that delta x r gamma lambda n. So we have to optimize lambda in that case and x. And gamma, so we have two parameters. Gamma is the step size that you use in Langevin. Lambda is the step size lambda is the regularization factor that you have to choose. And then, once you have done all this optimization, you obtain a dependence in the dimension, which is d5. So d5, and we have the similar bound for Wasserstein distance, D5 was much better than the Bubek. We have D12. Bubek is working in Microsoft, so it costs a lot, much more than me. So, and we have a much better dependency in dimensions. So there is someone of Microsoft, I'm available. And so they use this basically, and they use some correction on the boundaries as they prove that they prove that what they prove basically is that what happened on the boundary is not when you have a convex body which is well rounded, so then what happened in the boundary is not too bad because the diffusion doesn't spend too much time around the boundary. So the paper is very complex. I think it's wrong, by the way, but it's a cold paper, so I think it's wrong. It has never been reviewed, I would say that. So it has never been reviewed, but it's a lot of calculation, very detailed calculation, to prove things like that. And there is a paper by Lovach and Vampala, which is better, which is D4. So they have a better algorithm, which is... They have a stronger assumption on kappa, and they use a different algorithm. It's an hit-and-run algorithm. It's a different, it's a kind of heavy ball. It's an hit-and-run algorithm in that case. And they prove D4. And so we have other applications like this. Okay, so we have a lot of results. I have indicated a lot of, I have some, I will leave my slides there. And then you have results. I have other papers. So this one, so that this is a paper of normalizing constants. So the last part I did not present it. Something from low concave on compact on convex compact domain is a paper in Colt. This one has appeared in Siam Imaging, and we have several other papers in preparation, but more with stochastic gradient Langevin. I did not have time to explain what is stochastic gradient Langevin, and I just end up here. Thanks a lot for your attention.